Good morning.
There we go.
It's time for our call to worship. The earth has its kings, but God is ruler of all.
Praise God above all, the giver of life.
The mountains may tremble, the oceans may roar, but God's presence is more powerful than the earth itself. Come into God's presence, for God is among us now. O God, show us your glory. We seek your ways. Come to the rock, the God of life, for God is present now. Amen. If you'll stand for this morning's hymn.
Thank you. Amen. You may be seated. We want to welcome those who are watching online. We're glad that you are with us this morning. We are continuing our summer sermon series about the songs we sing. And so every Sunday, I pick a hymn or a song and I preach on that. Today is a one that has been very challenging because it consists of four sentences. So, and most three of those sentences repeat itself. So it's been a real challenge, but I've enjoyed it. In a couple of weeks, the last Sunday of August, we are going to have a very special service here, and I'm so excited about it. It's a service specifically for caregivers. So if you are a caregiver and you are at home watching this service, or you know someone who is a care provider, we want to encourage them to come to church that Sunday. And we are hoping to have volunteers from our congregation who will then go and relieve that caregiver and sit with the person so that the caregiver can come here and be in church for that Sunday. Isn't that exciting? I don't know of any other church doing that. And also we hope to have some pictures of our caregivers, our shut-ins, and also if they are able, that they will participate in the service. And I don't want to spill the beans about that. So share that news on Facebook. The last Sunday of the month, a special service for caregivers. Can you do that? What a great ministry. All right. So I want to invite anyone who is having a birthday or an anniversary to please be recognized and come forward. Do we have birthdays or anniversary celebrations? Wow, that's... Oh, no, last week was, help me out, Marilyn's birthday. She turned 90. Okay, so no celebrations this week.
Rosie Jacobs.
She's on the ninth. I saw Rosie a couple days ago. I was hoping she'd be here today. All right. Rosie, happy birthday. Okay, so I'll ask them for the kids to come up so we can help set the theme for today, what I'm going to talk about. Good morning, everyone. I love your energy and your smile. So I was thinking about today's song, and it's called Spirit of the Living God. What do I have here?
Balloon.
A balloon. Is it really a balloon?
Yeah.
No, why?
It's
right, you have to put, you got to put something in it, right? So this balloon has a shape, right? Mm-hmm. And if I start to fill it up, right? It takes its shape and makes its purpose, right? And gets bigger and bigger, and eventually we can tie it and display it, right, for a celebration. Well, the song that I'm going to talk about today is about the Holy Spirit. How the Holy Spirit comes to us. Now, the Holy Spirit, what is the Holy Spirit? The Holy Spirit is kind of God and Jesus working together in our life, okay? And the Holy Spirit comes to us in various ways. We don't see the Holy Spirit. We don't necessarily hear the Holy Spirit, although sometimes you may, by a tugging in your heart. You know, have you ever had a thought, why is that happening? Why am I feeling this way? Or maybe you have something that you know you ought to do and you're kind of afraid to do it. Or you have something so happy and wonderful happen and you just want to give God, the Holy Spirit, all the praise. So the Holy Spirit comes and enters into our life, right? And we're also told that once we have the Spirit, we are filled with love and patience and kindness and goodness and all that wonderful stuff. Okay? So remember that The Holy Spirit will come and fill you with all good things. And I want you this week to try and be loving and kind and patient with one another. Okay? God is at work in your life. God is at work in your life. Allow Him to come and fill you with your presence. Okay? All right, you can go with your teacher now to Sunday school. Folks, we also have a need for volunteers. We are blessed to have these children with us week after week. Sometimes we have more, but we need some volunteers. So if you are able just to give one Sunday a month, just one Sunday a month to help us, that would be greatly appreciated as well. So I want to continue to encourage you to give of your tithes and your offerings. I want to thank you for all the things that we are doing. The food pantry is, it seems like we are getting more and more people every day. We're starting now with back to school supplies. I want to thank you for that. I just want to thank you that that we are keeping this building maintained and staffed. So thank you for all the ways in which you are allowing that to happen. At this time, I'll ask the ushers to come and wait upon you for your tithes, your offerings, and your prayer cards. Our song. It's the song that I'll be preaching on, but it's more suitable if you just stay seated so you can just be in fellowship with the Holy Spirit and watch the words on the screen.
We have a lot of prayer concerns this morning. I want to first lift up some of our church members. Bill Nicholson is back in the hospital. I saw Bill this week. Bill's not doing well, folks. So I ask that you will be with him. And I told Bill that we'd be praying for him. Want to continue prayers for Charles. I've tried to reach out to Charles, but I haven't gotten any response. But Charles' health situation is not good either. So let us continue to keep Charles in our thoughts as well. About 3 weeks ago, Rose brought someone to church. His name was Smitty. And Smitty came with his granddaughter, but Smitty's not doing well either. So, again, we need to keep him in our prayers. Mark and Sue normally comes and serves as the liturgist. They both have COVID, so that's why they're not here. Rhonda, I understand. Butch, were you able to get a hold of her this morning?
Yes, I did. She fell. She hurt her arm. And she hurt her belly.
Okay. So, Rhonda... has fallen, and Rhonda, if you're watching this morning, our thoughts, our prayers, and our love are with you during this time. And then I look around and I see others who are still recuperating from surgeries. I want to ask that we continue to lift up Loretto and Jack as they are recuperating. Terry, we continue to pray for you and your situation. And then Rita has asked also that we continue to lift her family up and all her family members as they are going through a trying time as well. Now I want to get to yours. Prayer requests. First is prayers for Pat Nix in Georgia. concerns with cancer treatments. They're not working right now. An associate at work, Christopher, has had a clean scan and tumor has shrunk, and he wants to thank you for your prayers. Amen. Tammy Neal is in stage 4 with pancreatic cancer. Let us continue to pray for Tammy and her children. Prayers for Patricia, who is having health issues and difficulty getting a correct diagnosis. One of our youth, Dottie, is out this morning. She has pink eye. And Marilyn is not with us because she's not feeling well today. Lynn Anderson, experiencing stomach issues. Let us continue to pray for Scott Pennington and his family, and especially for the upcoming school year. My husband received word this week that his father they found two small tumors, and so I ask that you will pray for his father, Richard, during this time, and pray that those tumors can shrink. And then with the start of the school year coming up, Adam is going to start school this year, and this is the first time that Adam is going to be apart from his mother. And we know that that can be challenging and difficult for both child and for mom. So we'll pray for Adam and for Sarah. And then also for Sarah's husband, Max. Max is having some health issues as well. Every Monday, I turn these cards over to our prayer group. Okay, hold on. Yeah, thank you. Yes, we have cards out there for Bill and Charles. So every Monday I give these cards over to our prayer group, and they spend an hour or sometimes two just in prayer, and they pray over these cards. So don't think that, you know, we don't do anything with them. We uphold every person on this list in our thoughts and in our prayers, and in trust them into God's hands. Let us pray. Spirit of the living God, come and fall afresh on us today. God, we gather this morning and we have shared all these concerns, all these needs. There are some that we have not shared with you, Father. They're too private, too personal. But we know that you are a God who listens, a God who intervenes, a God who directs, a God who forgives, a God who reconciles, and a God who heals. And for that, we give you thanks. We pray, Lord, for this community, that they will come to see our love for one another and the love that we have for them. As we go and serve in these schools, Father, we pray that you will bless the children that we meet. We pray, God, that we will be an inspiration to families. We pray that we will continue to feed and provide goods that they need. We pray, God, that we will be known as the church that is clearly the hands and feet of Jesus. Be with us in the coming weeks ahead. We pray, Father God, that we will discern, ask for discernment in this decision that we are to make. May your Holy Spirit guide and direct us. Thank you, Lord, for this church. Thank you for our church family. and be with us today as we worship you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Our scripture readings for today come from 2 Corinthians 3:3. You show that you are a letter from Christ, the result of our ministry, written not with ink, but with the Spirit of the living God, not on tablets of stone, but on tablets of human hearts. Also from Psalm 42, 1 and 2, as the deer pants for streams of water, so my soul pants for you, my God. My soul thirsts for you. My soul thirsts for God, for the living God. When can I go and meet with God?
Well, you all know the saying, sometimes simpler is better, and that's what today's song truly is, a simple song consisting of four little sentences. But I love this song, and I thought it was the perfect choice for this Sunday as we gather for Holy Communion. It is a song that quiets our soul and invites the Holy Spirit to move and stir within our midst. And today is a good day to just pause and reflect on how the Holy Spirit is active in our life, of how God is on the move, stirring us, preparing us, shaping us, and calling us as individuals and as a church body. The song Spirit of the Living God was written in 1926 by Daniel Iverson. He wrote the song after hearing a sermon on the Holy Spirit during an evangelical crusade. Some of the lyrics Mr. Iverson copied from a hymn that was sung during the revival, while the other lyrics were written by himself, and he wanted those lyrics to focus upon the work of the Holy Spirit in our lives. When the hymn was completed, it was made into leaflets and passed out at other evangelical crusades for the attendees to sing as part of their worship service. So as a result, the hymn became very popular and found its way throughout the United States and abroad. And today it is popular among various church denominations, and it has especially become a favorite among youth and college students. If you'll look at the slide, you'll see that the lyrics are easy to memorize. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. Melt me. Mold me, fill me, use me, Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. One of the scripture passages for this morning reminds us of the importance of basking in the Lord, of realizing that we need to take time to seek the Holy Spirit in our lives, that we need to thirst for the living God. Psalm 42 says, as a deer pants for flowing streams, so pants my soul for you, O God. My soul thirsts for God, for the living God. Does your soul thirst for God? Do you long for the living God? Did you hear what the psalmist wrote? The living God. The living God. God doesn't merely exist, but he also lives and moves among us. Did you know that the title, the living God, appears about 30 times in the Bible. Moses and his people experienced the living God. In Deuteronomy 5:26, we read, "For who is there of all flesh? For who is there of all flesh that hath heard the voice of the living God speaking out of the midst of the fire as we have? Go and hear all that the Lord our God shall say, and speak thou unto us all that the Lord our God shall speak, and we will hear it and do it." Joshua 3:10, "And Joshua said, Ye shall know that the living God is among you, and that he will without fail drive out all your adversaries." Psalm 18, verse 46 says, "The Lord lives, and blessed be my rock." Jeremiah says this about the living God, "But the Lord is the true God. He is the living God and an everlasting King." And Simon Peter also said, or shall I say, he confessed this, "Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God." I hope this week that you have enjoyed the beautiful days God has given us. Have you considered recently how wonderful it is to draw near to the God who exists? The God who lives and who is the fountain of life? God is not a statue. He's not obsolete or dead. He is the God of salvation. The Holy Spirit is active and alive in my life and your life. God is on the move, directing and changing lives, restoring relationships, mending our brokenness, providing hope, urging us, prodding us to find Jesus. So today we come to the table to be fed. We come to the table to drink of the cup of living water, the cup of salvation. May we never quit thirsting for God. I want to move now and talk a little bit about the Holy Spirit. I've put together some slides for you to help you follow in the dialogue here. We have come to understand that God's Spirit is part of the Holy Trinity. We know Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and that the Holy Spirit has been around for a long time. Our first slide reminds us that the Holy Spirit has been around since creation and continues to be active in us and the world today. In the first book of the Bible, in Genesis chapter 1, we find that the Holy Spirit is moving about the surface of the waters. And in the end of the Bible, the last book, in Revelation 22:17, this same Spirit culminates by inviting others to come to Christ, so their spiritual thirst can be quenched. From Genesis and throughout the entire Bible, even at the end in the book of Revelation, the Holy Spirit has always been active, creating, guiding, equipping, and offering us the opportunity for salvation. The second is that the Holy Spirit was present on the day of Pentecost and continues to reveal itself today. In Acts 2, we learn that the Holy Spirit comes and descends upon the apostles and other followers of Jesus Christ while they were in Jerusalem. They were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit enabled them. The third thing we know is that the Holy Spirit was also present during each stage of Christ's life. When the angel appeared to Mary, the mother of Jesus, he declared, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you." Later on in the baptism of Jesus, the Holy Spirit was present. When Jesus was baptized, he went up immediately from the water. The heavens suddenly opened for him, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and coming down on him. And during his ministry, Jesus taught and put a lot of emphasis on the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit was the subject of intense prayer. Jesus says, "And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another counselor to be with you forever. He is the Spirit of truth." And then Jesus also explained to his disciples that they would need the Holy Spirit in their lives for various reasons. The Holy Spirit will provide them with wisdom and power, but the Holy Spirit will also call them to be witnesses on Christ's behalf. The Holy Spirit will, like our hymn today says, melt, mold, shape, fill, and use us to advance Christ's kingdom. And the last point I want to make is that the Holy Spirit is present on the Lord's day. In the book of Revelations, we come upon an interesting passage. The book of Revelation is written by one of Jesus' disciples, John. John is the one whom Jesus loved, the one who cared for Jesus' mother, and the one who was also present during the day of Pentecost. And John writes this letter to several churches as an old man. In fact, he's about 90 years old. And he writes from a prison cell, from an island in the Aegean Sea known as Patmos. The island was about 40 miles off the coast of modern-day Turkey and was known as the Roman penal colony. It was a harsh place. Criminals were sent there to rot and die. John was sent there because he was a criminal of his faith. His faithfulness to the truth, his beliefs to Scripture and the Word of God, and his testimony on behalf of who Jesus Christ was, ended him up in prison. You see, John's allegiance was to Christ and not to the Roman government. And yet it is here, under these harsh circumstances, that John gives us something to really think about. In Revelation 1, verse 10, John writes, "I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day and heard behind me a great voice." John writes, "I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day." I love that phrase, "I was in the Spirit." Why do I love that phrase? I'm going to tell you why. Where is John? He's in exile, locked away in a cold, stinky, dark dungeon. And what does he say? He says that he is in the Spirit. He's in the Spirit. He's in fellowship with God. He's singing the Bill and Gloria Gaither song, "There's a Sweet, Sweet Spirit in this place, in prison. There's a sweet, sweet Spirit in this place, and I know that it's the Spirit of the Lord." Friends, in the midst of bleak circumstances, John was cut off from all believers. He was cut off from Sunday church service. And what is he doing? He's in the Spirit. Amen? He is allowing God to speak to him. He's being attentive to God, moving and acting in his life, and he meets with God, and God meets with him. There are some days I know that, quite frankly, you don't want to come to church. Some days I don't want to be here. Maybe your friend is not, maybe you're tired and you're not feeling well. Maybe your mind is sidetracked. Maybe you're upset with the preacher or members of our church family. But nonetheless, you come anyway. I come sometimes tired and worn out and frustrated. And in those moments, the Holy Spirit comes. and God somehow refreshes our souls and speaks to us, doesn't he? Friends, if you are in the Spirit, God will meet you and you will meet God. It doesn't matter where you are, what baggage you bring, what location you're in, whether you're in church or sitting in the car, at work, whether in a hospital room, whether you're playing outside or working outside or in your home. By God's grace, you can be in the Spirit. You can be in fellowship with Him. Don't ever forget that God is still at work, moving and shaping and directing your life and our life here at Miami Whitewater. Think what could happen if you are in the Spirit, not just on a Sunday morning, but on any given day, anywhere. We cannot live nor do ministry without the Holy Spirit. There is no area of our life in which the believer does not need the help of the Holy Spirit. And so when the Holy Spirit is in us, what happens? The slide, the lyrics, He melts us, He breaks us, He molds us, He fills us, and He uses us. And so I just want to quickly look at each one of those, because the author carefully chose each word for a reason. The first is, melt me. The original translation was, break me. Break me. Several months ago, I preached a sermon on how God shapes and refines us. And I talked about how a silversmith refines silver. Do you remember that? How first the silver is thrown into a furnace and then retrieved and shaped by the silversmith. And the silversmith knows when it's the right temperature, because as he takes it out, he can see the reflection of himself. Sometimes God has to melt us or break us. God wants a contrite heart. He doesn't want a proud and arrogant person. He wants a humble, honest person to come before Him and say, melt me and mold me, fill me and use me. The second is this, mold me. In order to mold something, as I shared with the children, you have to have some type of form to pour the substance into. Otherwise, it just spills out. It goes all over the place, doesn't it? The key to molding something is making sure that the substance will take on the identity of the shape. So it is with the believer. 2 Corinthians 3, verse 18, all of us then reflect the glory of the Lord, and that same glory, who is the Spirit, transforms us into His likeness in an ever greater degree of glory. Fill me. The Holy Spirit equips us in ways that we can't even imagine. But before He can use us, He must fill us with all good things. The fruits of the Holy Spirit: love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. The Holy Spirit begins by working on our hearts, our mind, and our actions to become more like Him. I like how this person put it. He said, when a person is filled with the Spirit, they are allowing His presence to fill their entire life, every room in their life, every closet, and every junk drawer. True. And the last point, use me. The Holy Spirit wants us to be ambassadors for Jesus Christ and to go about the business of making disciples. After His resurrection and just before Jesus ascended into heaven, Jesus said to His disciples, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and all of Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth. Maybe you are in a work environment where you and another person may be the only Christians in your workplace. Maybe you are living alone in an apartment or a retirement home. Maybe you are a stay-at-home mom caring for your children. Maybe you are a care provider. Maybe you just feel inadequate and useless. I'm too old, Lord. Maybe you are thinking, yes, Lord, I want you to use me, but I just don't know what to do. Maybe you're feeling stuck. Perhaps you question how you will acquire the finances or skills to get the job done. If you have thought any of those thoughts, I want you to remember John. John, the person who wrote the book of Revelation, the guy we talked about earlier, the 90-year-old stuck in prison on a deserted island. John had nobody. He lost his church. He couldn't preach to believers. He was stripped and taken away to prison. His ministry had come to an end, or had it? It was in this place that John saw, heard, and experienced the Holy Spirit. This is where he got the vision of heaven. This is where John got to make history. This is how John changed the world. This is why believers know of the assurance of things hoped for and that salvation and eternal life is real. The Holy Spirit came to John. It was in this place, this out-of-the-way prison place, this bleak, dreadful, isolated place that God gave John his greatest ministry. I'd never thought about it in that way, had you? It's interesting, isn't it? So when God speaks to you, don't just turn away. Stop. Take the time to be in his presence and say, Lord, here I am. I'm listening. You see, God wants to use you. God isn't done with you if you're 60 years old. September 5th, mark it on your calendar. If you're 70 years old, if you're 80 years old, if you're 90 years old, God isn't done with any of you. Amen? Amen. Very quickly, before we take communion, I want to briefly mention our second scripture reading for this morning. So on the slide here, 2 Corinthians 3:3, Paul testifies to the Corinthians, you are a letter from Christ, written not with ink, but with the Spirit of the living God. Not on tablets of stone, but on tablets of human hearts. You are a letter from Christ, written with the Spirit of what? Say it, the living God, on the tablets of human hearts. And so on the first Sunday of every month, we come to the Lord's table to prepare ourselves for the living God. And we leave this place renewed and refreshed so that we can be his letter for all to see. But you're not just supposed to be a letter written with words and a bunch of ink. Oh no, you are supposed to be so much more. You are supposed to be, remember this, a living, breathing, walking testimony about the goodness of the living God. Amen? So let me wrap up today's sermon with one other simple reminder of why we gather today at the Lord's table and why we need to remember that the Holy Spirit of the living God is upon us each and every day. The reminder is found in our communion liturgy. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world. Amen. Follow along on the screen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. And now, with the confidence of children of God, let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. On the night in which Christ gave himself up for us, he took the bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice, in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. Amen. All are welcome to come to the Lord's table. I ask now for those who are helping to please come forward, and then the ushers will guide you to come and receive communion. If you want to just spend some time with the Lord, feel free to do so.
it on the other side of her. Ushers, you may now direct the congregation to come forward.
Okay.
Let me say how much of a joy it is to see you come up and just receive the elements and be obedient to the Holy Spirit, as some of you just stayed to feel his presence. As I saw the children come up, there's a sweet, sweet spirit in this place. Amen. I love when we have communion. I love the chaos. I love the kids. I love watching you come. Thank you. Not all, you don't feel that in every church. But I feel something. I feel a spirit in this church. Let us stand and join together in our closing hymn, Sweet, Sweet Spirit. Go in peace. I hope you have been revived this week. Amen. Amen. Amen.